Because you what? Now think of affirm. Because you agree, you know. You affirm, you know better. So you did something you knew better not to do. Does that work for you? That's the sin of commission. What about the sin of omission? Drop the C. And probably drop an S too, or an M. You're dropping a couple of letters.
Omission would be misconveying the truth.
Misconveying the truth? What else? I think he gives something else in there too.
Those notes you gave me, I didn't read that.
So misconveying the truth, that sounds like something you said last week. Do you want to explain that? Explain, boss.
Yep. How many M's in omission? Can't remember.
Two. So it's like O,
thank
you. And mission. S-S-I-O-N.
Thank you. Co-mission.
Yeah, well, actually, omission has one M. See, and commission has two M's. That's where we get mixed up.
That's why I get it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And two S's. Yep.
I'm going to try to really simplify this. Commission, you were not supposed to do something, and you did it.
And you knew it.
Yeah. We'll get into that. But you did it. Let's just leave it as did it, okay? Omission, you didn't do it. You're supposed to do it, and you didn't.
Yeah.
So you could mess up by not doing, and you could mess up by doing. Now, give me an example of something that you're supposed to do and you didn't do, and it's a sin. I'll give you a hint. Every Sunday, Katrina gets up there and talks about it. Pay your tithe. You're supposed to do it, and you didn't. That's a sin of? Omission. Thank you. 1M. Give me an example. 10 Commandments. Something that you're not supposed to do, but you did. Lie. You know you're not telling the truth. Oh, sorry. That's lie for your hair. See? Lie for your hair. But you see the difference, right? So I just wanted to clarify it so that when we use these terms, I want you to make it simple. Commission, you did it. Omission is like omit. You're supposed to do it and you didn't. I hope that clarified it for everybody.
So I'll give you a second to add that to your notes so that we don't have to struggle with what sin is anymore. It's missing God's mark in two ways. You know you wasn't supposed to do it and you did it. Another one is you ignored what you were supposed to do. And that ignoring can be either because you knew you were supposed to do it and you ignored it, or you didn't know that you were supposed to do it, so you still ignored it. Okay? Are we clear? Are we on the same page about what sin is? Okay. So how does trespass and transgress differ? I hope Reverend Vernita still has a mic. No, they are going to talk to me, but, you know, after they decide that they're not going to talk anymore, we're going to do A side, B side. Transgression, trespass. Same, different. There was also, you know, kind of an understanding or a little kind of debate on all sin is sin. I don't really want to get into that because I think next week we can get into that a little more. But trespass versus transgress, let's go. Who was here last week? I think I saw Reverend Dana on the camera. I think I saw Reverend Diane on the camera.
I'm going to give you a hint.
Oh, no, don't give him a hint. Let's see. Come on.
Can I give a hint?
Give a hint.
Remember, you see that old man? Think of the old man with overalls and
the
dog.
She got it. You want to give it a mic?
That's trespassing. You can trespass and not know you've trespassed.
Uh-huh.
Because that's the example
right.
You gave. But being on someone's property and not knowing that you really crossed certain lines.
That's right.
And you're on the property.
That's right. Like, Poppy has, some property. And you don't know when you're walking on his property when you've stopped walking on his property. Unless you look for this little thing in the ground, this little tiny thing with a certain color flag on it. Right? Land. No, well, yeah, kind of. I don't even know what they call it, but I don't see it, so I never know. I never know I'm on the other guy's property. I trespassed. You with me? You with me, right? You trespass. So there's a little line here. You see this line? If you say to me, don't come across this line because you're on my property, and I go and I do it anyway, I've done what? I've trespassed. God says, don't covet your neighbor's ox, nor your neighbor's ass, nor anything that is your neighbor's, and you covet. We trespass. That's why Jesus says, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespassed against us. Forgive us for crossing boundaries in the same way that we're going to forgive other people for crossing ours. Sin, trespass, transgression. Good. You're doing good. Transgression. Transgression. Come on, Renita. We got to go.
Transgression is in. Transgression is intentional. Mm-hmm. See, you can trespass, and the focus on a trespass is that you've crossed the line. But transgression means you knew what you were doing was wrong, and you decided, you intentionally decided to do it. So,
say that again.
Like David and Bathsheba.
Go further.
No, well, you know, he saw the woman bathing, and he took another man's wife. That was intentional. Mm-hmm. He had the man killed, put in the heat of the battle. That was intentional.
Because he intended to have that woman. He intended to covet Uzziah's wife.
So it's all sin, but sometimes the scripture has a focus when it comes to the sin. It's still sin. It's all sin. But the focus on transgression is your intent.
Yes. Are we clear? So looking at it and saying, I want that even though it belongs to somebody else, and I'm going to get it. Jezebelish. Transgression. Okay? Transgression. All right, so you're doing pretty good. Are you all with me? What is iniquity? We sometimes use sin and iniquity interchangeably. Sometimes in a psalm you see sin and iniquity in the same song or in the same poem. One is one line of the poem and the other one's the next line because it's meant to be seen as synonymous. But we know that things that are synonymous are not the same, necessarily have the same definition. What is sin? Well, what is iniquity? Iniquity. 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 Okay, we could talk about it a little later. I'll give you time through the lesson to get it. But I think that we're so stuck on sin is sin that we don't recognize the nuances and that in the scripture, sin is not sin. And we'll talk about that, you know, as we start rounding off this particular quarter. Missing the mark is one thing. Transgression is related, but transgression is the intent to take that thing or do that sin or dishonor God or the intent not to conform. It's an intent not to conform. It's an intent not to conform, right? Trespass is, oh my gosh, I crossed the line. But what is iniquity? Okay? And I'll even give you time during the lesson to look it up because I think it's a little good for you to work at night. I don't think I should work alone. Is sin abnormal? Is it you know what I mean by abnormal? Yeah. Is sin not normal? Sin is very normal, isn't it? What made sin so normal? Why? Why? How did you get there? What fall? The fall in the garden. Who fell? Adam and Eve, but who fell particularly according to the scripture? Adam. Okay? That's why later on you don't find that it says, you know, we had one man, Adam, we had one woman, Eve, and now we have an Adam. It falls on Adam. In Timothy it says, you know, listen, the woman was the weaker vessel. It was the man's fault that we're in this particular issue of sin. And that we're in a fallen state. Paul was very clear to articulate that to us. Okay? So that's how we got there. I don't like to take for granted that we all know how we got there. For a lot of people, church is a social club. It's just a place you come and feel good. It's not a place you come to reckon with your sin. So tonight we're going to reckon with sin. Okay? So how should we see sin? You know, we all see sin differently. Those reminders were for us to really look at and see and make sure that we're working from the same definition, because if we're not, then we needed to, you know, stop and course correct. But how should we see sin? And I'm getting have some help tonight from the Catechism, and also I'm going to get some help from J.I. Packer's 18 words. That's why I started off with giving you some of those resources. So how should we see sin? This is a quote directly from Williamson's Catechism book. I hope you all have a Catechism book. He says, people have sometimes said that they cannot understand how such a little sin, like Adam eating that fruit, that's the little sin he's referring to, how such a little sin, like a boy taking an apple from a neighbor's tree, could bring such a terrible result. What result? The loss of life, loss of the garden, death, and even the punishment of hell. Doesn't that sound like Joshy? So some weeks ago, Joshy was like, all I did was touch it. Remember when who was here when he said that? But what's wrong with touching it? All I did was look, so I can't look at the tree? This was week 3. Remember that? It's okay if you don't remember. But that's how we view sin. All I did was look. But look at what you're looking at. You're looking at what God commanded you not to look at. God gave the order. He said, don't do it. And we just justify like Joshy. We just justify, but you know, I just dipped my toe in the water. I didn't go all the way. I just kissed him. We didn't go all the way. How is that sin? He just hugged me and I just let it linger. I didn't go all the way, right? I didn't even kiss him. Look at this. We don't understand how such a little thing results in such a big consequence and such an eternal consequence. You know why it goes there? Just let me answer it straight up. Simply because God said, don't do it. And he did it. All right? When we see that sin is one of conformity unto or transgression of the law of God, when we see, in other words, that sin is terrible because it is against the great and good and holy God, sin is terrible because it's what? Against the great and good and holy God. Pause. When we do not include God's holiness in our analysis, we're already wrong. It's a sinful perspective already. If you ever try to take sin outside of transgressing a holy God's holy law and holy order, then you will never see it as sin. And then, after that, you just keep moving with the music. It's my thing. Do what I want to do. Because God's holiness doesn't factor in. Again, this is all G.I. Williamson's words. When we are able to see that it is against the great and good and holy God, we see that it is unworthy objection. What's an unworthy objection? That it's just a little thing. That it's just a little thing. It's a white lie. It's not a big lie. I just told a little lie. It's not that major. It didn't hurt anybody. Nobody got hurt. I didn't even include anybody in my little lie. When you put your little lie against a great and good and holy God, your analysis, my analysis about it being so small that it didn't hurt anybody is an unworthy objection. Amen. Are we clear?
Yes.
You shouldn't send me to hell for that. Come on. Okay? People who talk that way about sin show that they don't even know what sin looks like and they don't look at sin the correct way. We always have to look at our sin in relationship to God, his person, and his law. Look at sin in relation to what? God's person and God's law. What? God's person and God's law. Otherwise, we'll never see how great our so-called little sin that didn't hurt anybody is. The fact that it offends God is enough. God, Jesus said this. He says, don't fear him that can kill the body and after that can do no more. But fear him, meaning God, who can kill the body and after that can throw the soul into hell. The fact that God sees is enough. Not that you didn't get caught. We're always living for the gotcha moment. That's not the way to see sin. see sin as an all-seeing, all-knowing, omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent God looking at everything that we're doing, and he has a standard, and he has a law, and his law is it, not our analysis. It didn't hurt nobody. That's not the standard. Whether or not somebody got hurt is not the standard. And that's why we get caught up in comparing sins. Well, at least I'm not like that. You know, I have my issues, but I'm not transgender. At least, well, at least they like a guy. You know how we say that? Doesn't that sound familiar? Well, ooh, thank goodness they like a guy, and at least they don't like a girl. Wrong focus. Wrong focus. Affirming sin right there. You're okay with sin because you're unholy. Those are unholy remarks, unholy thoughts, unholy view of sin. And it certainly doesn't carry with it the holiness of God. Are you with me? Are you tired? Okay. I'm also pausing to give you room to check your thought life. You know, I wear this Fitbit everywhere, right? And it tracks all my steps. But let me tell you, my sin bit is my heart. It is recording every action, every thought, and it is registering in heaven. In the shower, out the shower, my sin bit is on. Asleep or awake, my sin bit is working. And this sin bit is recorded in heaven. Are we clear? Yes. So it has nothing to do with whether or not we got caught. Caught at the point of the origination of the thought. If a man thinks to sleep with another woman that is not his wife, Jesus said he's committed adultery already. He's missed the mark at the point of the what? The thought, not at the point of the action. The sin bit registers. It registers in heaven. If we have not learned about sin, we cannot understand ourselves, is what J.I. Packer says in 18 words. Who always like talk to kids and they like, who am I? What's my identity, sinner? If you have not learned about sin, you cannot understand yourself or your fellow man or the world you live in or the Christian life or faith in general. You just can't understand it. And you will not be able to make head or tail of the Bible, for the Bible is an exposition of God's answer to the problem of human sin. Once you move past Genesis 1 and 2, everything else is about God's exposition on sin. We don't need a Genesis 3, 16, all the way to Revelation 21 if it wasn't for sin. That's it. That's why the Bible is here. What is God's exposition on the problem and his answer on human sin? Unless we know that clearly, we will keep missing the point of what the Bible says. That's why you have people like John Piper and those guys who find prosperity gospel and also our bishop so abominable. Because it doesn't tackle sin. God's going to bless you. Tongue down somebody else's throat, but God's going to bless you with a plane. Right? It doesn't really deal with sin. Whereas the Bible from Genesis 3 onward gives you God's perspective on sin. And his answer to sin, redemption. It's the ball starts rolling, the camera starts rolling at Genesis 3, 14, 15, 16, and so on. Okay? So how should we see sin? How should we see sin? It looks like I printed this twice. Apart from the first two chapters is what I'm up to. Apart from the first two chapters of Genesis, which set the stage, the real subject of every chapter of the Bible is what God says about our sins. If we lose sight of that, we lose our way through the Bible at once. We cannot even understand the Bible without understanding sin. With that, the love of God, the meaning of salvation, and the message of the gospel will all become closed to you. You will always be in how to study the Bible saying, I don't understand, 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 I don't understand. I don't know. What is that saying? I don't get it. I don't get it. Dr. Torres calls them blockheads. I don't get it. A block of sin head. Sinners never understand. Everything from Genesis 3 on is about the problem of sin. there's nothing else to understand. You understand what I'm saying? Now, these are really rich stories, and so I can see how we get caught up in the tapestry of the story. I do too, right? But notice how it all falls down to what was the problem with that person, and how did God answer that problem, and how does God redemption work? If we don't need redemption except for sin. We don't need Jesus except there was a problem with sin.
That's right.
There's no need for Jesus without sin.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So the fact that we have Jesus and we're saved, that means we have a sin problem. There's no need for sanctification if we're sinners, if we're not sinners.
That's right.
You fall, you get down, you fall, you get up, you fall, you get up because we're sinners. That's what sinners do. But the grace of Jesus Christ is a saving grace.
Yes.
So even while we're sinning and getting up and we're guilty of our sin, we're not guilty of our sin at one point in time. We're guilty of our sin at all times. But the key of our salvation is that he paid the price for that guilt. And not only are we guilty of the sin, but we have incurred God's wrath. It's not just about separation. It's about incurring God's wrath and indignation. Because he's a holy God looking at our unholy stuff. Okay, so now when he sees us as saved, we have what? The blood of Jesus covering us. If we don't have a clear view of sin, we need to fix our minds so that we can have a clear view of sin. We have to fix our minds so that we can have a clear view of sin. But that's not easy, right? It wasn't easy for our forefathers in the faith, and it's not easy for us today. But this is not easy for at least three reasons. In the first place, I'm at the watering down the doctrine of sin slide. In the first place, the biblical doctrine of sin doesn't compliment you nor me. It doesn't make us look as beautiful as Mac and Sephora. Okay? You want to know why it's hard to read the Bible? Because we always see our crap. We always get a chance to see how ugly we really are. And just how desperately wicked our heart is. I told you, it's registered on the sin bit. So we naturally move away from any view that doesn't make us look beautiful. That doesn't compliment us. That doesn't make us feel good. You know, people would say, well, why do I have to keep going to Beth Rapha when they just keep telling me how terrible I am? The whole Bible tells us how terrible we are. If you leave here feeling good all the time, then we probably didn't preach the word. If you, I'm not saying feel depressed, because we can leave feeling hopeful, because that the gospel brings hope and it brings life. Okay? But if you walk away feeling like, yeah, I got that, then we didn't preach. If any of us preach and you walk away feeling like that, you should come to us and say, thank you for making us feel good. And preachers, we ought to say, ooh, I missed it. We need to hang our heads.
Amen.
And say, we missed it. Yes. We completely missed it.
Jesus.
We did not do what we were ordered to do. We did not preach that word.
Lord.
Am I saying you have to leave depressed? I'm not saying that. You can leave hopeful, but soberly hopeful,
yes.
Because the word is meant to put our sin in perspective. Okay? And help us to understand why we need to be sanctified. And that God is sanctifying us. The self-excusing instinct. It's a what? It's an instinct. We immediately forgive ourselves. Well, I didn't mean that. I stepped on Vernita's foot, but I didn't mean it. And she should know me better by now to know I didn't mean it. Self-excusing. That's why Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. Because just like you give yourself slack, give your neighbor slack. We have this natural proclivity to excuse ourselves. Singing Patti LaBelle, if you don't know me by now, you will never, never, never know me. Self-excusing. That itself is a product of sin. The ability to excuse ourselves is a product of sin. Genesis 3:12, you want to take a look at it with me, Reverend Brown? And that instinct to excuse ourselves is very strong. It's as natural as the air we breathe. We are very forgiving. Here begins the reading of God's word. And the man said, the woman that you gave me, she did it. She did it. She gave it to me, God. And all I did was eat it. All I did was eat it. And by the way, she wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you. You the one who said it's not good for me to be alone. I'll make a helper. You. So ultimately, you did it. That's serious, folks. That's serious. Ultimately, you, it's your fault. It's not even her fault, really. We need a mic over here. It's your fault because it's the woman you gave me. Reverend Brown needs a mic. It's the woman you gave me. She gave it to me, and I ate it. Self-excusing, strong.
So defending oneself is also a product of sin.
I think possibly. Ultimately. Possibly, and I only go the possible route because I think that there are facts of a situation, and I think correcting facts is important so that things don't have to be repeated. But if you're trying to defend your intent, I think that's where the self-excusing comes in. Bishop, what do you think? Self-excusing, yeah.
I agree that it depends. If someone accuses me of stealing or and it's not true, and it needs explanation, there's a difference between explanation and defending, because defending is protecting yourself. Explanation is just bringing clarity. I wasn't stealing the book, I was just moving it from one place to the other, which just required clarity. But when you go, I'm not a thief, you know, why you call me a thief? Have you ever seen, you know, that's defending, you know. So there's a difference between clarity and protecting one's image.
Because protecting your image is to excuse yourself from what the person saw or experienced. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Self-excusing. So hence the temptation comes to what? Water down the doctrine of sin. The watering down of the doctrine of sin started with our man Adam right here. Not even owning that I ate it. You told me not to eat it and I did. Instead, God, it's your fault. If you didn't give me the woman, I wouldn't have had anything to eat, see? It just would have been fine. I wouldn't have been tempted. She was tempted and she ate. She was deceived, rather, and she ate. But he disobeyed God. So, you mean we're no good? How we ought to see sin. So, you mean we're no good? Sin. Let's talk about sin and good men. Good men have been yielding to the temptation to water down the doctrine of sin since the church began. I'm in J.I. Packer's 18 words. It needs grace and spiritual enlightenment to believe that our sin is as serious a thing in God's sight as the Bible says it is. If we don't believe that our sin is serious, then we have to check the grace. It's not that the grace is not available. It's not that the grace is not available, but we haven't received it. Anytime you having a struggle with your depravity, your total depravity, what do you really believe about grace? Yes, yes. What do you understand about grace?
Yes. Sin is so important. I was talking to Katrina about it, and I don't want to get far ahead of the lesson. But your concept of sin is so important because it will determine whether you are an Arminian or a Calvinist. If you are a Calvinist, we taught this in the church, so Flo, if you have any questions, see me in the back if you need more information. But I'm. But, you know, Calvinists believe that when you fell, or when Adam fell, rather, mankind was so depraved. We're talking about what sin does, how sin affects you. Mankind was so depraved and in sin that he didn't have the ability to clean himself up. So now you have to look at, when you look at sin, you have to look at the impact of sin. And the way you view the impact will determine whether or not you're a Calvinist or you're an Arminian. Calvinists say, because it's in your nature to sin. It's not just that you sin, but it's in your nature. In other words, it's part of you to sin. You know, it's almost like a frog. You know, the frog leaps because that's how he gets around. It's in the nature of the frog to leap. How are you going to tell the frog not to leap? You know what I'm saying? It would seem silly to say, frog, don't leap. Go and walk over there, right? Because it's in the nature of the frog to leap. And it's the same way the Calvinist says, it's in the nature of man to be sinful. And the impact of sin is so bad or has so impacted man so horribly that man cannot want God. Because to want God is to want to change your sinful nature or start the path of trying to be not sinful. So the Calvinist says sin has wrecked who you are. Yes. That you don't even want God. The Arminian says sin is bad. Sin is bad. Very bad. I feel like Saturday Night Live. It's bad. I'm sorry. Sin is bad, but you know, you still have a choice, and you can want to do good. And you see it all the time. 12 steps to this in a book here, 10 steps to that. You watch Oprah, enlighten yourself and do things, whatever. And so you can now be a better you. Listen to the language now. You can make yourself a better you. And you sit down and you have Deepak Chopra and all those people tell you how to be enlightened, right? Because the impact of sin is not so bad that you can improve yourself. See what I'm saying? So the point is, this whole lesson here, when you listen to Katrina talk, the impact of sin will determine if you're a Calvinist or an Arminian, and then depending on the impact of sin, then you define grace.
Yeah, that's right.
Is the grace, because if you are so nasty and so far gone that somebody had to come get you out of your muck, then the grace that the Calvinist believes in is a very strong grace. But if you believe that you could do 10 steps to Jesus,
a better you.
10 steps to this, 12 steps to that, right?
Yes.
Then grace now is just influential.
It's an hors d'oeuvre.
No, it's influential.
Yeah.
It's an influence, but you ultimately join with the influence, and
you make it better.
See, and that's what Super Saturday? Super Soul? Whatever. Super Soul Sunday and all those things, a lot of those shows, if you really... Serenity set. If you pay attention to that, they'll tell you what to do, but that's the underlying current. You come alongside it and make it better.
And grace wouldn't be what it is without you.
See?
Without you. That was awesome. That was awesome. So what do we need to do? We need to do, in light of what Vernita said, and J.I. Packer says this, we need to pray that God will make us humble and teachable when we start studying this theme of sin. This is not a head study. This is a heart MRI. Okay? This is a heart MRI. It's even more detailed than a CAT scan. Yes, please, say a lot.
This is why in this church we believe in biblical counseling and not in Christian psychology, so to speak. And we do have a battle in the house. There's some leaders who still have a propensity to integrate the two. Because biblical counseling always comes back to depravity and always points to the solution to depravity, which is the word of God. Counseling says it's your mama, or maybe if you go back, it's your father. There's always that underlying tendency to shift the blame. You don't deserve to be treated that way. Somebody did something to you and you should be treated, well, you know, they're doing that because they're a raunchy sinner. And the only way to be delivered from it, whether your mama drop you or your daddy drop you, is sin that keeps you from embracing the healing power of the grace of God. And many of us in here still resent biblical counseling. When I say to you, go to the counseling course and take it and stop seeping up a little of integrationism, you get mad and go undercover. But you see what you bought into. a little influence of your little learning.
No, keep your mic on. Keep your mic. One thing that comes to mind is not only do you kind of think about the, you know, the raunchiness of it, but you received the sin that somebody did based on your raunchiness too. So they weren't the only one raunchy in the situation. Right? So even your proclivity or my proclivity to be the victim is filled with sin. There's nothing righteousness in it. There's no righteousness in it. You get what I'm saying? So Pastor Robinson elaborates. I think this book by Reichem really deals with that too. So I'll talk a little bit about sin and relationships in a minute. But just how you receive the so-called offense is sinful. Okay? So so-and-so said something to me, and I was offended. I didn't like the way Katrina said that to me. Right? Just by the fact that, you know, I didn't like the way she said it. And you start, if you really just ping your sin bit, you know, when you ping something on a computer, you ping a server, when you ping your sin bit, it'll, because I didn't like the way my mother talked to me like that. That sounded like my mother. I was somewhere on Monday with a group of friends, and one friend was talking, and I said, wow, she reminds me of somebody. And I've known this person for years, at least for a couple of decades. And I'm like, who does she remind me of? And on Wednesday morning, oh, she reminds me of my youngest aunt. And I hate the way she talks, you know? Because when the person was talking on Monday, I was like, oh my gosh, I wish she shut up, you know? And I love usually when they talk. But I didn't understand on Monday why. I was like, I just wish she would stop talking. And I didn't say anything. I didn't even cut them off. I just kept listening because I needed my sin bit to show up. And I needed God to reveal that thing. And by Wednesday morning, she reminds you of your Aunt Stephanie. How your Aunt Stephanie talks. I said, oh. So I began to just, you know, pray. Right? I just began to pray. Because she was saying some good stuff, but I couldn't really hear her on Monday. Because I was like, she reminds me of something. I just couldn't understand it. I wish we had recorded that conversation, because I know she was saying some really good stuff, but I just couldn't hear her. All I could say was, I wish she stopped talking. But I wanted her to stop talking because I have an unresolved relationship with my Aunt Stephanie. No, I don't have an issue. I have an unresolved relationship with my Aunt Stephanie. You see what I'm saying? Because we hide under issue too. Saying I have an unresolved relationship means get on the phone, Katrina, and when you go to Brooklyn tomorrow, find Stephanie. Before you go to that 40th dinner, go find Stephanie and resolve the issue. So that next time this friend who was saying some really wonderful stuff talks. Now, why did it come up now? I've been knowing this person for a couple of decades. I mean, I've been listening to him talk for a couple of decades. We've been on some trips together. We have really great conversations. But on Monday, I wish you stopped talking. That's all it was. You get what I'm saying? Sin showing up. Showing out in this relationship. And I missed hearing something that could have probably saved my life. In those 10 minutes of saying, I wish she shut up. You get what I'm saying?
Yes, we do.
Okay? That's how sin is working all the time, every day. Every day. And I'm not abnormal on that. I know I'm not. In the second place, the biblical doctrine of sin emerges from the biblical knowledge of God's holiness. Yes. Knowledge which is in short supply these days.
Yes.
Since sin is properly understood only from the inside, as we find it in ourselves, what was my sin? Just not being able to hear her based on an unresolved relationship. That was my sin at that time. As we find it in ourselves, and like Isaiah in the temple, we start seeing our sin in ourselves only when we are consciously facing our holy God. That's why we can't run from the presence of God. We don't know how totally depraved we are without his holiness and presence. We don't know. We just don't know. We just don't know. We just don't know. Most of us today, however, lack there. Who's there? Isaiah, Amos, Hosea, Jeremiah. Remember all these guys? Ezekiel, Paul. Now let's look at John, Augustine, John Calvin, John Owen. We lack their knowledge of sin because we lack their awareness of God. We don't know God. We don't know sin. We don't want to know God. There's no need to know sin. That's why we shun God. The more aware we become of God, the more aware we become of our total depravity, the more we understand grace, and the more we receive the grace. And the more, can I add this? The more we begin to appreciate the fact that everyone I interact with is a sinner, whether they're saved by grace or not. One thing I know, I was talking to another buddy at one point in time, and I said to them, I said, you know, it really struck me one time that I started praying this prayer similar to this, may I be as impatient with my own sin as I am with somebody else's. May I not ever put my mouth on somebody's fault, big or small, more than I put my mouth on my own fault. Because to do that, to go the other way, is again to not recognize how much grace I really need and what God really saved me from. And then I'm putting a little salt on the grace, making it better. Putting a little, you know, making it nice. No, that grace needs to come. And not just hit, but hit me over and over again and explode. And may it ever explode until we see Jesus face to face. May I not ever do that. So in the third place, the biblical doctrine of sin has been secularized for modern times. We made it secular. People today still talk of sin, but they no longer think of it theologically. That is in relation to God. That we call it issues. That's why I had to pause and I had to say, no, I'm not talking about issues. I'm talking about, you know, the problem is this disconnect in this relationship. We need a microphone. He had a hard day in school.
I just want to push pause on right here. Yeah. When the people forget, they really forget about the consequences.
Your mic is not on.
They really forget about the consequences. Mm-hmm. And they really don't realize the effect that they're causing when they sin.
Give me an example of the effect that they're causing when
like you mentioned the fact that when David with Bathsheba, his sin kept going on. I mean, the consequences was after he did what he did, it elevated to the guy dying, but it really rippled into the next generation. It started going on and going on. And at that time, if David knew all the consequences that he had to face after this act, he pretty much wouldn't have done that even when he got tempted. So that's what I'm saying. We don't realize the consequences that it continued to go on and on and on from not just the act, but it can continue to be, it could continue to be sinful, and then now the consequences will jump to generation to generation, and like David. So that's what I'm looking at. You know, we don't really think about our consequences when we go into the act.
Amen, amen. And then I wonder too, and sometimes people look at it, and I'm not correcting what you're saying, but I just want to add to it. A lot of times we just think about the consequences of sin, as opposed to just who are we really offending? And why isn't it just enough that we offended God? Why we got to try to run from hell? Just the fact that we offended a holy God who called us out of darkness and brought us into his marvelous light, that's enough. That's enough to be grievous over our sins and wickedness. Just to recognize, like Renita said earlier, with the Calvinist understanding, is that we could have never saved ourselves. We could have never made anything correct ourselves. Renita, you were going to say something. But it's just enough. Why isn't that enough? Because that's how depraved we are. You see what I'm saying? So I just wanted to add to it. So we kind of run to the consequence of the action. And then it doesn't quite register with us that the action started at the thought. And it starts at the heart, the sin bit. Right? You see what I'm saying? A little bit, kind of?
Did I?
No, no, go ahead, keep going. I'll repeat it. Our deeds of the past.
From deeds of the past to, thank you, sir. The deeds of the past to salvation now. We are forgiven from sin. Does this now is an ongoing situation?
Mm-hmm.
But at the cross, at the crossroad, does Jesus forget and wash us from our sins?
Yes.
And forgive us from our sins and, you know, like the ongoing consequences I talked about?
Yes.
Is it an ongoing process now? Do I have to now continue to pray that, okay, God, I have family members, I have children, I have grandchildren. When does it stop? You know, when does it stop? Does it continue to go on? Am I, you know, so what's the purpose of grace? What's the purpose of mercy? If
does
I'm have to, I'm just saying, what
no,
the,
no,
is
I'm
the purpose of that is, if I have to constantly praying, okay, God, I see what's going on now. I understand what you're doing. You know, help me to, you know, help me so it can stop the process.
So why couldn't it just stop at one time? Like, I, Willie Littles, am saved. Why can't it just stop right there? Right?
That's what I'm asking.
Because the consequence of sin was always death. Right. Right? But with redemption, but the gift of God is eternal life. And then you said something else. You were like, so why does it have to keep going generation to generation to generation? Because that was the consequence. He said to Adam, don't eat. Because in a day that you do, you shall surely die. You will certainly die. For God to stop that is to now go back on his word. He's not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. If he spoke at that one time in Genesis 1 and 2, then it's sufficient. And that's just what it is. So we can't do, and as sinners, we want the quick fix. Like, and then also, let me say this real quick before you go again. That kind of thinking also tries to exonerate us from responsibility. We don't want to be culpable. So if I said the prayer one time, just let that be the prayer for all generations. I mean, come on. No, we always have to give an account for the deeds done in his body, whether they are good or bad. Ecclesiastes and Corinthians teaches that, right? We have to give an account for every word spoken. We have to. It registers. Now, in terms of whether or not we pay the wrath, right? Because it's not just a sin. It's not just a slap on the hand. We have a very major misnomer about what the consequences are. It's not about give me a slap on the wrist and let me go. When we stand before Christ as the elect, or stand before God as the elect, Christ will speak for us. Look at Zechariah 3. Not us. We won't even be able to speak for ourselves because we have nothing to say except I'm guilty. All you and I will be able to say as saved Christians is we're guilty. And I loved every bit of the sin I did. And the enemy will accuse us. And Jesus will be changing our clothes from our dirty, filthy rags that we shouted in every Sunday, which is wickedness to him and unrighteous and disgusting. And I remember Bishop preaching one time that it's like a minstress, a used always pad. That's a lot of smelling. That's a lot of, forget just the blood. Just forget how it looked, but the smell. That's what my righteousness and your righteousness look before God. Our checklist, our so-called right doing, our so-called goodness, that's how it looks before God. We don't have another argument. We don't have another plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. That's it. There's no more. We don't influence grace. We receive grace. We don't perform for grace. We receive it because you know what? Not only, you have two hands in the back. Not only, Vernita, did he come and pick us up out of the mire, but we were dead in our sins and wickedness and in our trespasses. You know what dead means? How many of you got people in your family who's dead? Go to the graveyard and call them and tell me if they answer you. They can't answer you. They can't answer you. I don't care what the soothsayer says. When Saul went and looked for Samuel as a dead man, right? The witch called him up. Samuel said, "Listen, leave me alone," because he knew better. He said, "I ain't got nothing for you, man." So yeah, can people have seances? Probably. but they still have nothing to say to you. Dead, you're dead, you're dead. Dead in our sins, dead. D to the E to the A to the D, dead. So this is not a grace of influence. It's a grace that when we were dead made us alive. Three hands were up. Toya, Reverend Wanda, and Reverend Jackson. Oh, okay. Toya, your hand was up for the mic. Oh, amen. Reverend Jackson wasn't worshiping. I'm sure he's got a lot to say.
No, the thing I wanted to say is, and I like when you talked about being more sensitive to my sin just as well as I am to other people's sin, is I think we think in the process of sanctification that we get to a point where we think things are better or we're okay. I think that's what happens to us. Because through growth and maturity, we think that there's a place that it has gotten better. But even as we're sanctified and we're separated from certain sins, we are still the same sinners. And it has not gotten so much better that we can see things differently. What it is that we're growing and maturing and we're continuing to be sanctified, but we are still sinners saved by God's grace, and we have not been empowered to be better or do anything better. It's the power of God and the grace of God that has gotten us to the point that we are. And we still need to look at sin the way it was 3 days ago or 3 months ago. Because we can still fall tomorrow.
Yes. Oh, and fall the next second.
And continue to fall.
It's just a thought.
And it's continue. And even when we think we're better, even thinking that we're better is
a
problem. And that's what gets us to the point where we feel like we're better than other people.
Yes.
And that's damnable.
Yes, it's a sin.
And it's a terrible thing. But when we look at sin the way it is, you'll be very slow to look at somebody else's sin, and you'll have, like Pastor Robin says all the time, I have nothing but mercy for you. Because it's you today, and it can be me tomorrow.
And Jackson, not only are we, you know, just so-called getting better, we just become sophisticated sinners. Right? Sanctification is really happening and it's really working, but our mindset toward it has to really change. Reverend Charles?
Just to segue into this, talking about sin secularized,
yep.
I want you to make sure when you, I want you to make sure when you think of sin now, to use the definition that we are giving you in this class. Mm-hmm. It's so important because when you talk to other people and they talk about sin, we talked about this in the last class, the definition is, do you hurt anybody? Completely, I'm telling you, when you talk to people, you cannot assume that they define sin the same way. I'm telling you, you're talking about apples, and they're talking about kumquats, and you don't even know that you're not talking about the same kind of fruit. I'm serious. You will hear people say things like, even the gay SCOTUS decision, right? You hear people, we love each other, we're not hurting anybody. The justification for the marriage is that we love each other and what? We're not hurting anybody. We're adopting children, see? So I'm saying when you listen to people talk about sin, it is not the same definition. Because if sin was, what would we say? Want of, I'm going to repeat this because some of you may not have been here the last time. So this is Fred. You know I'm artistically challenged. So this is Fred, right, with his hat and his suit. This is a suit, pretend it's a suit, okay? Thank you, right? And this is God's law. Let's just pretend. We talked about this before, God's law, right? When you don't conform, it's the same thing in graven images. When you don't conform to the law, you are not bringing yourself, you are not coming up to the standard and forming your life around the law. That's why it's called conformity. Right now, then I'm done. Conformity, right? I spelled that right. Form. Form. You're taking the shape. Con. With. With the form. of God's law.
So when we say sin is any want of conformity, that means basically the outfit ain't fitting.
It's not tailored.
It's not tailored. You're doing something else. You're supposed to have pants on and there's something over there hanging out. It's not fitting. It doesn't fit God's standard. And when you see it that way, your definition of sin is different. And please, when you listen to people, remember that. They are not using that definition. And I suspect that when we talk about sin secularized, you're going to see that. Look at that when Katrina talks about that.
Oh, I'm almost done because we're going to go into examples of relationship, but that was good. That's like Campbell's soup. I'm just going to read this part of the slide before we go to the last one. Don't show the last one yet, media team. But where it says, in the third place, the biblical doctrine of sin has been secularized in modern times. People today still talk of sin but no longer think of it theologically, meaning having God's understanding of it. The word has ceased to convey the thought of an offense against God. And now today, it signifies only a breach of accepted standards. Okay? It's a breach of accepted standards of decency, particularly in sexual matters. It's just a little indiscretion. We call them indiscretions. So when we read, I'll give you a quick example. I'll probably go over a little bit more in a little while, but Monday's New York Times was really a shining example of that particular slide where, you know, I started in the op-ed page on Monday. I just, you know, felt like starting in the op-ed page, in the op-ed section. And look at the articles in the op-ed section. I thought I had it there because something else caught my eye, so. But anyway, one article was on, here it is. One article was on Kim Clark's decision to not give marriage licenses in Louisville and Kentucky. So it says, we don't need a clerk in jail. That's one article. So that has to do with same-sex marriage, right? Sexual matters. Another one is sexual attraction and fluidity. This is by Charles Blow. You see him on CNN all the time, the tall black man with a baldy. So in this particular op-ed piece, he's talking about how sometimes he's attracted to women and sometimes he's attracted to men. And that how normal it is to sometimes be attracted to women and sometimes be attracted to men. And then another one says, you know, help for the way we work. And that one is talking about how people go to work or show up at work but don't work. But all three of those articles are about sin. And then I turn the page. And I, after a while, I just couldn't stand it. Oh, I'll get it, Pastor Robin, no problem. The other article on page A14, thank you, says police abuse of transgender people persists, advocates say. Sexual matters. And we talk about it so normally. So that's the op-ed. Then I start working my way backwards in the paper, and I get to the front page. And by this time, I just had it. I was like, oh, God. So then I get to the front page, and the front page says, ousted as gay, aging veterans battling again. That's like five articles in just one section of the New York Times about sexual matters that are perverse to God. Yes. How we define sin is important because the world is normalizing it. Yes. The New York Times, I don't think I ever read so much about sex in the New York Times as I did on Monday. I was like, oh my God, and this is just one section. I didn't even want to touch the other sections. I was done by the transgender article. Then when I went to the front page trying to see, okay, what's really important in the world right now? Ousted as gay. And you know, Americans, we read from left to right. So that's in the left. The important article in the New York Times is always on the right. But they made sure they put that right on the left, right under the image for the day. I said, God. Because the world sees this as a minor indiscretion. They don't see it as an act against God's holiness. And they want us to view it the same way they view it. This is not sin. God doesn't register anywhere in any of these articles in this newspaper, and he certainly didn't register with people and a Supreme Court ruling. Reverend Amy, then I want to go to, if you guys don't mind, I just need about maybe 5 extra minutes tonight, just 5.
Well, Bev, I majored in journalism, and Beverly, from a PR perspective, she brought something out about the New York Times, so go ahead and say it.
No, I was just, when you read that, and then you get to the cover, and the New York Times, their motto is, all the news that is fit to print.
So basically the standard of what is fit to print, whereas, you know, when we were growing up, homosexuality was never discussed in this way.
It's like so
now it's fit. It's considered fit to discuss, fit to be in the public discourse.
Yeah. And you know why it's fit in the public discourse? Because their worldview is not a biblical worldview, right? So remember the book I told you about earlier, Christian Worldview, A Student's Guide by Philip Graham Ryken, R-Y-K-E-N. Here's what he says about sin and relationships. You do know every relationship we're a part of is sinful. You do know that, right? Okay, we're in a whole Lego thing of sin with every relationship. That's a result of the fall, okay? So even if God joined you together, okay, sin. I'm not saying marriage is sin. Let's be clear. I'm saying two sinners got married. Are we clear now? Are we clearer? Okay, amen, 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 amen. Anybody feel beat up? Okay, amen. Amen, amen. Two sinners married. Okay. The loneliness that sin brings is horizontal as well as vertical, affecting not only our relationship with God, the vertical, but also our relationships with other people, the horizontal. Having rebelled against God, we now find ourselves estranged from one another. So it's not just separation from God, it's also an estrangement from each other. Sometimes the problem is that we expect too much from other people. Longing from relationship, we hope that friends, lovers, and family members can give us something that it turns that only God himself can provide. Our desire for relationship is good, but we demand too much. And soon our disappointment with other people turns to conflict.
Yes.
Have got conflict? Remember that Got Milk commercial? Got conflict? There's sin. Got conflict? There's sin. Before we move to confrontation, let's find the sin. And let's confront the sin and not the person. The breach between Adam and Eve became obvious the moment they sinned and felt the need to protect themselves from the unbearable scrutiny of another human being by wearing clothes. When God asked if he had eaten the forbidden fruit, Adam said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it." Genesis 3:12. This was hardly chivalrous of him. Adam's confession, "and I ate it," seems to come as an afterthought. His real concern was to shift the blame to Eve, not to mention shift the blame to God. And this is the way fallen human beings ever have been ever since. We excuse our sin by saying it was someone else's fault.
That's right.
I would not have yelled at you if you hadn't. Well, I only responded that way because you did.
That's right.
If you didn't do that, then I would not have said that. You see how we go back to Genesis 3:12 all the time, and we excuse ourselves. We can only imagine the bitter arguments that Adam and Eve had during the long, sad years after Eden. See how clear he writes, right? "If only you had never eaten that forbidden fruit," Eve would say. "Well, you ate it first," Adam would say. In Paradise Lost, John Milton describes their endless recriminations. "Thus they had a mutual accusation spent, the fruitless hours, but neither self-condemning. And of their vain contest appeared no end." End quote. That was from Milton's Paradise Lost. Milton was right, Ryken says. There is no end to human conflict. Always sinned, but never sinning. Always sinned against, but never sinning. Everyone's a victim, but never the villain. There is discord and disharmony at every level of human relationships. At every level, no matter how much you're in love, there is disharmony and discord. That is the natural order of a fallen people. In the church and out of the church. Yes. Elected or unelected. Yes. Redeemed or doomed. That's just what it is. Estrangement is common in the home where husbands are angry or unfaithful. Wives are critical or judgmental. And far too many marriages end in divorce. Children disobey their parents while parents pick on their children. The elderly are killed in the name of mercy while unborn never see the light of day. There is also estrangement in the church where each group claims to have God on its side and look down on people who do not think or worship or serve the way they do. Then there is estrangement in society where men and women wage an endless battle of the sexes, often to the disadvantage or exploitation of women. There is estrangement in the workplace where competitors use and abuse one another to get ahead in their careers, and where corporate greed claims excessive profits off the backs of ordinary employees and out of the pocketbooks of helpless investors. Bosses abuse their power and workers rise up in rebellion. We see the same thing in a wider economy, where exploitation is so woven into the fabric of the global marketplace that the poor are often enmeshed in the cords of injustice. And there is estrangement around the globe, especially in the form of armed conflict. Nation rises against nation, tribe against tribe, dictators oppress their own people, terrorists commit random acts of violence, and superpowers provide weapons that fuel the fires of war. We are not guided by love, but we're held captive of hatred. Sin in relationships. Grab this book. It is called Christian Worldview, A Student's Guide by Philip Graham Ryken. Okay? And we'll conclude with this. I didn't even need the extra 5 minutes. Hey, now. Yes, go ahead. Yeah, Ryken. Philip Graham Ryken. R-Y-K-E-N. Here you go. You can't keep it, though. Thanks. So are we ready for the conclusion of the matter? We shall never know what sin really is until we learn to think of it in terms of our relationship with God. Sin is turning out the way he has commanded it. This is what I want to leave you with. Sin is doing what God commanded it to do. Hello. Exodus 32 and 8. Sin is doing what God said it would do. Into a forbidden way of our own, Isaiah 53 and 6. Sin is going contrary to God. Sin is retreating from God. Sin is turning one's back on God. Sin is defying God. Sin is ignoring God. Are we clear?
Yes.
More next week. Any thoughts, any questions? We have 5 more minutes. Actually, 2 minutes. No? Okay. Well, have a good night, Bishop. Your people.
Wait a minute. Toya had a question. It was all over her. We ready?
Bless the Lord. Oh, my soul. It was interesting as I was watching a video on a gentleman. I forgot what he calls his name, Dr. Somebody. One of those Breakfast Club situations. And he was talking about, he's, you know, into going back to Africa type thing. And he was talking about homosexuality in the black community, to white supremacy, all types of things. And my question is, thank you, Reverend Nita, what, when the postmodern mindset says that, in terms of homosexuality, that the person is born this way, what are they really getting at? You know, what are they really commenting on when it comes to either God and God's grace? Like, what is being, what's the point? I hope I'm making myself clear.
Oh, you are, and here's what I would like to do with you if you don't mind keeping the microphone. I want you to start answering the question. What are they saying? When they say they're born this way, what are they saying? You can phone a friend, Wanda Lilly, she wants to help you. Reverend Moses is ready to help you too. No, I want you to start.
That they were born this way, meaning I assume that.
So born this way.
Born
this way meaning they were born gay.
Yes.
They were born attracted to the same sex.
Yes.
Okay. I just want to be clear.
So there, what I, and this is what I, what my head says. Mm-hmm. There, because this is how, it's almost like, oh, I was born with no arm. Mm-hmm. So I can't hit the ball because
I don't have an arm.
You can't tell me to throw with my right arm because I don't have an arm. So that's the only connection that I've
So then what does the Bible say?
Does
the Bible say anything about it?
Of course.
What does the Bible say?
The Bible says that we're born in sin and shaped in
iniquity.
But
how does the Bible say we were born in terms of our sexual
nature? We were born male and female. Yes. He created us in the likeness of himself.
Yes. Male and female created he them. So that's, let's start there when we're asking and answering those questions. Is what was God's design? And then secondly, the example that you use. So then that example kind of brings me to think that somewhere in there could be an understanding of homosexuality as a disability, right?
Exactly, uh-huh. Because in this interview, they were talking about the DMS-5. I forgot what is that, psychological.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. I think I saw that video.
Where, you know, he was saying, now you have to open up the door. Now, if there's a gay gene, then there's also a pedophilia gene. And now we got to legalize all the disabilities, you know, all of what they called. Of course, it's sin, but one of the secular terms is mental illness. It used to be called mental illness.
Mm-hmm. And now they're taking it out of the DSM as a mental illness because now it's normal in our society, right? So one blaming, thank you. Say that again. Say, you need a microphone. So now we go back to God created he, male and female created he them. So now we go back to, like Jackson is saying, he's going to say it himself. It goes back to?
We continue to just do what was done in the Garden of Eden. When people say that, what they're doing is excusing themselves from the responsibility of living the way God said they're supposed to live. And then not only doing that, but making a strong point and saying, God, it's your fault.
Yes.
Because I was born this way. Yeah. So now you're telling me to live different from the way I was born. No, they're right. They was born that way. They was born in sin. Yeah. Yeah. So it's true. It's just that they calling it something else. Yeah. And we do that all the time. We look for excuses to have the ability to live the way we want to live. And we're not seeing it. The way Katrina's been teaching all night is seeing it God's way and the way he sees it. So we're excusing our own responsibility in this matter, blaming it on God, and trying to say something different. I remember you was teaching before, and they've decided what to call good. Mm-hmm. Only God makes that decision. Mm-hmm. We don't have a right to say what's good. And that's what even the paper is talking about, what's fit. What's fit is what the people have accepted now so we can talk about it because it's acceptable to most people. So they're just looking for an excuse.
Sin to sinners will always be in vogue, right? And it is only be how much more fabulous can we be? You know, so really, really good point in terms of it's now going back to blaming God. You know, one thing that I want to lift up as Bishop comes forward is that Bishop talked about biblical counseling. And one of the things that Jay Adams talks about all the time is he says, start the counseling session with prayer, but tackle the sin. Don't go anywhere else but to sin. And if any of your counselors are doing anything else other than sin, I would just, you know, book another appointment and ask them to pray. Pray, because we recognize that this is all based on sin. And help me to really, you know, confront the sin in my life and to conform to be with God's form on what the Bible says that I should be. Because, you know, as saved people, he has basically given us his Holy Spirit, right? Which is a part of himself. We can sin less. we choose not to. And that in itself is sin as well. Amen, everybody? Amen. Everybody's all right? All right, I'm going to take my seat, Bishop. Beth Rafa. Beth Rafa, Bishop.
I think we should just stand and put our hands together for this wonderful team. Oh, we can praise the Lord, this wonderful team. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Just 1 second. You can be seated, and then we're going to receive the evening's offering. As I was listening, one of the things that was asked was about consequences. And when you focus on, you know, consequences, now, should I always have to worry about what's going to happen to my life, what's going to happen? Again, what we're looking at is not God and what he feels about the sin. It's not the fact that we have offended him. It's the fact of, why is my life becoming uncomfortable? Why do I have to be? It's there it is. It's about me. It's about me and my children and my children. It's not about, oh my God, we all deserve to die because we have offended you. And we are glad for the grace that you've given us so that at least we can have a relationship with you. When we start thinking about ourselves, it's never about God. But talking about, let me just say one thing. The reason why people justify homosexuality is because they have feelings. Anybody who has feelings for the same sex, ask them crazy questions. Or make those crazy. When you start having feelings for the same sex, it's because you're rebelling against what God called you. God called you woman. God gave you a vagina. And it should go somewhere else other than to another vagina. And the moment you start feeling that, then you're going to gravitate to even listen to that stuff. That stuff shouldn't even be listened to. The Bible says it's a shame to even mention them. It's a shame to, it's because you're having feelings. And you take those feelings to the Lord and say, God hates this. He hates this feeling that I have. He hates the porno that I'm watching of women having sex with women. And because he hates it, I want to hate it too. Until you get like that, you'll always raise your hand and ask some crazy question because you got the feeling. The feeling is against God. Anything I do that's against God, it's sin. And I should be more concerned, not about the consequence, it's about offending him. He's a holy God. He's a central, he is the subject of the sentence. He's the subject of the sentence. All right, this was my meditation this morning, not even knowing that you all wouldn't talk about this. It's in 2 Peter 2. Verse 6, and then I'm finished because I'm not trying to reteach. It's just so rich. You know, teaching stirs up teaching. Preaching stirs up preaching. All right? So 2 Peter 2, 6, just add this. And it's coinciding with Jude. And turning, this is God, turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Listen to how he deals with the abomination of sodomy. He turns the city of Sodom and the city of Sodom and Gomorrah into what? Ashes. Did you hear what I said? He didn't just sweep it. He burnt it to ashes. You understand? If I had feelings for another woman and I hear that, I would run home tonight and sleep on the floor. You burnt the city to ashes? Because that's what you hate. And what? Condemn them with an overthrow, making them what? An example unto us for the 21st century. So that in case any of us feel the same way, we start getting nervous. If you burn them, you'll burn me. That's how much he hates it. And the other verse says, and their behavior vexed Lot. The Christian church is not vexed enough. we call it tolerance. I thank you so much. I thank you. I ate every bit of it. I'm a fat cat tonight. I love it. I love it. I love it. I thank God for this church. I thank God for the teachers. This church has been blessed to have the rich word of God broken down in a simple way so you can live your faith. You only can live what you know. If you don't know it, you can't live it. Amen. Amen. It's like somebody saying, well, you know, if I stay off my job, the consequence is that I won't get paid. No, I work because it is right. And I must please my boss. Yes, yes. Ain't no consequence. I must honor the one in authority. Again, it's putting God as a sidekick. All right, let's bring our offering. Thank you, Reverend Vanita. Thank you, Reverend Katrina. Thank you, Reverend Jackson. Don't leave without me talking to you. Yes, we're going to bring an offering tonight. I'm excited. You know why I'm excited?